I grew up without electricity.
So I am what is known in the US as a hillbilly. I grew up in the foothills of the Rocky Mountains, technically the Blue Mountains. My family was roughly hippies. This is actually not as much of a jump as you'd think, because I grew up around a lot of different types of technologies. Most of it was more physical. So how do you fix a truck? But you can remap a lot of those skills into computer science. And so I kind of got into computer science thinking it was more what I was observing from my mother's tech crowd that would go and fix her computers. And I found that to be kind of fun. You got to mess around with a lot of the same things you could with tractors.
I'm originally from Mauritius, tiny little island lost in the Indian Ocean. So yeah.
When I was a child, I grew up with this fascination with outer space and, you know, like with lots of kids, I wanted to be an astronaut. Growing up in India, that was a very strange kind of dream because at that time, there was only exactly one guy from India who had gone to space and not on an Indian spacecraft at that time.
The reason I got into AI was I was reading a lot of science fiction as a child, and you know, Isaac Asimov and so on.
At around, I don't know, maybe 11, 12, I somehow unexpectedly myself discovered mathematics as a field that absolutely fascinated me. And I was trained as a mathematician, and I moved to the States. And since by that time I had written a couple of papers on sort of boundary, on theoretical computer science, on boundary of computer science and mathematics, I decided to retrain as a computer scientist.
I was interested in computers from a very young age. Like many others, I was interested in games originally. I really liked playing games. But very soon I also had an interest, I wanted to find out how these things were developed in the computer and how you could execute these games.
I started in a very small village, town, hamlet, like in a very rural place in a kind of remote region of Austria. I went to university there. I studied computer science.
Personally, I wanted to do research. I wanted to become a professor. I think I realized this around 11 years old, and I hatched a plan then about all of the steps that I would take. So it's been a lot harder journey than I thought it was at the time when I was 11.
When I was about 14, and I was trying to work out electrical circuits with motors that would automatically open and close the curtains in my bedroom to sort of wake me up at the right time in the morning. And I had no idea I would get to this kind of area.
As a child, I was interested in both science and language a great deal. And as a teenager, I was uncertain whether I wanted to pursue science or literature. But I was fortunate enough to be selected by my city to represent them at something called the London Youth Science Fortnight. And I went to this event when I was 17 and was exposed to many different scientists, leading scientists, talking about their work in universities and in industry. And this completely switched me on to being a scientist.
So back when I was a high school student, my first computer showed up at home. My dad bought it. It was, you know, a big clunky desktop machine. I got really interested in programming.
So when I was a student in high school, I watched the Robocom, which is a robot competition. And in that competition, students build up robots and then try to control them in various ways. And it just looks. It looked very fascinating to me as a high school young student. And when I went to the university, I participated exactly in that competition.
Computer science was an accident. So in my high school, I liked physics a lot. So I wanted to kind of take physics, actually. But for various reasons, I ended up taking computer science.
Cryptography is a fascinating area that it was actually something that I picked up early on. I was very interested in the subject even as a young student in the math department. The first thing I learned about cryptography was that it was associated with interesting stories about government agencies and spies. And of course, that was something that inspired me to learn more about it.
I ended up in this field, like many people, it seems like an accident. I did a degree called engineering, not electrical engineering or computer science, a broad degree. It's kind of an information sciences and engineering degree.
I actually started with a chemistry degree. And then a very long time ago, I moved to Edinburgh to do an MSc in artificial intelligence. And it was while I was working on that MSc that I got interested in speech and language. And I did a PhD to do with machine learning, but also looking at speech recognition.
I started as a math major. So I studied math in my undergrad. And one thing I like about, I took some classes about theory of computing, algorithms and so on in my undergrad. And the thing I like about it over some math is that it's always very concrete. You know, you have some discrete, concrete problem to solve, and it's never sort of too abstract. So it's relatively easy to get to the frontier of the research in, say, computer science than in math. So I switched to computer science, especially theory of computer science, when I did my PhD.
I wanted to study computer science as an undergrad, but computer science on its own was maybe a bit too dry, so I combined it with linguistics. And the field of computational linguistics or natural language processing was really just emerging. It was a completely small niche area, and it wasn't at all clear that, you know, in 20 years' time there would be major corporations investing billions of dollars in this area.
I originally trained as a biochemist in Oxford. My interest has always been in genetics and understanding how the molecules that make up living organisms operate. And from there, I did a PhD in genetics, specifically looking at how various parts of chromosomes were activated and deactivated in different points during development. As I moved through that research, a lot of my work became more and more involving computers, trying to understand at big scale, genome scale, whole organism scale, how things are working. And so I began a transition into a more computer science type background.
I'm an engineer by training. I studied telecommunications for 5 years, following which I had a short stay with the industry. And after that, I thought I could do more intellectually, so I wanted to just do a bit more research. So I studied a PhD in telematics engineering, which is really trying to reconcile telecommunications and computer science.
I did my undergraduate in theoretical physics back in Italy, and I then wanted to be even more theoretical, so I got a PhD in mathematical physics in Oxford. And then after all those years, I think I realized that I wanted to do something that actually had to do with something that exists now, as opposed to something that might have existed in the first 10 to the minus 20 seconds of life of the universe. Then decided to get back into research, but into an applied mathematics and computing area. And I thought, you know, I thought climate modeling or bioinformatics were two interesting areas, so I explored a bit and eventually, you know, got a job in bioinformatics.
I did an undergraduate degree in mathematics and then actually a postgraduate degree in mathematics as well. So my first degree was at the University of York, and then my second degree was at a small American university called Lehigh, where it was partly I went because I wanted to travel.
My background's actually in biology. I'm a biologist to begin with. I did a PhD in genetics at the University of Glasgow, then postdocs in the US in Houston, and then came here to informatics about 14 years ago.
Originally, I was a mathematician. My first degree was in mathematics. In fact, all my degrees are in mathematics. I have no qualifications in computer science at all. And I went to do a PhD in pure mathematics.
I went to Oregon State University, which is a good university, but not the same thing as MIT.
I remember in my third year, I took a course in computer architecture, which happens to be my actual research area now.
I guess it really started as an undergraduate towards the end of my bachelor's degree, which was in computer science. Such things existed when I was a student. And I remember in one course coming across a lecture on an algorithm for the problem of matrix multiplication. Quite a simple thing, multiplying two matrices together. But the exciting thing about this algorithm was that it was highly parallel. this was, it's a thing called Kuhn's algorithm. And I just thought that was so clever and so exciting. It's like the most exciting algorithm I'd ever seen, which was, you know, great stuff.
I did my PhD in China. I spent a couple of years in Germany in Bristol before I moved to Edinburgh.
For me, my PhD was, for instance, about understanding mathematical reasoning. My research looked at historical mathematics, so look at Newton's Principia, which is about, you know, which was from the 17th century.
I wanted to do something, research in computer music, but I ended up becoming a computer architect. Computer science is such a rich field, involves mathematics, science, engineering.
I briefly worked in industry as a programmer, but I was frustrated that I didn't really understand how the computer worked. And so then I came to Edinburgh to the computer science department, as it was then, and did a PhD, still using my mathematics.
I was working as a systems programmer, and I realized that I was a lot more interested in understanding the reasons why we were doing what we were doing than most of the people around me. And so I didn't just want to know what to do, I wanted to know why. As a software engineer, I was felt like I was gradually rising up this level of skills, but I also felt like as I was learning these new skills, somebody was chopping off the rungs below me on this ladder. And this didn't seem like a very good situation to be in, and I decided it'd be better to be the person chopping off the rungs.
Sort of tied to Edinburgh with like a long piece of elastic, but I'm forever going away and working in other groups.
I've been working in this area for about 20 years, first at the Information Sciences Institute of the University of Southern California, later at the University of Toronto and the National Research Council of Canada, and I came to Edinburgh about 5 years ago.
I have been here now for 35 years. I actually came to do a master's, planning to stay for a year, and I'm still here.
How did I become head of school? That's a more tricky question. I found, as my career has gone on, as well as getting a lot of satisfaction from my research and my teaching, I also really like helping my colleagues fulfill their potential too, particularly the younger researchers. And so I've taken on various sort of management roles within the school, directing an institute, being director of research. And in some ways, I feel I've been in training for being head of school.
The University of Edinburgh is a great place to work. It has one of the largest groups in natural language processing.
I'm part of a centre called the Centre for Speech Technology Research, which combines the School of Informatics and people from linguistics.
One of the things that has been happening, at least in the School of Informatics, is a lot of interdisciplinary workshops where, for instance, people who are working on chip design might speak to people from AI, and people who work on AI might speak to people who are working on biology. And I think that's a great way to go ahead, because not only does it contextualize the research, but it also gives you an opportunity to talk to great people.
There are always interesting people coming to give lectures.
You can't find a single field that is not covered here in the school, I think.
Almost whatever you think of that you want to find somebody who's expert in, you can find somebody in this building who can help you with it, and that's a real strength.
I've been able to put together a team that has psychologists and sociologists on it in the school, as well as the machine learning people that do the data analytics.
There's no walls put up in the way of doing interdisciplinary research.
There are lots of new initiatives funded by various funding councils across the United Kingdom, Europe and the world that are helping interdisciplinary research projects between computer scientists, medics and basic scientists. The informatics department here is at the centre of a lot of those initiatives.
Sometimes the diversity can be challenging, you know, getting the, I don't know, HCI people talking to the machine translation people, and some of the connections are not immediately obvious.
We are a great university overall. So we have excellent biologists, we have excellent medical departments.
The city itself, it's quite vibrant, it's very cosmopolitan. the weather is not that great, but there's so many other things that compensate for that, the festivals. We're close by the sea, a lot of people overlook that. You cannot swim that easily, but you still get nice sunny days.
The city is great, it's beautiful, it's clean. I really enjoy walking to work every morning. No commuting necessary, having come from London, it's great.
By far is one of my favorite places to live, and I've traveled to many places in the course of my career and research.
We have a long-standing history of artificial intelligence research. In fact, the story goes that we got our, the Department of Artificial Intelligence here was set up before we had the first computer.
There were a lot of great people that have worked here, like there are these ACM Turing Award winners, there's Goddard Prize winners, Foxen Prize winners.
Edinburgh is one of the founding departments of computer science and particularly AI in the UK. We have a very long tradition of world-leading research in the city and in the university. And we're conscious of that tradition, but also very forward-looking. We're a large grouping of researchers, the largest probably in Europe and certainly within the UK, which means it's a very rich and dynamic environment in which to work. And the university itself is also large and offers many opportunities for collaborative work. And so we have colleagues who work with researchers in medicine, in engineering, in the College of Art, in politics and law as well, just to name some of them.
Edinburgh is a very rich intellectual environment. Something I particularly value about the way the university and the city are together, in some sense, our department, the School of Informatics, is at the center of Edinburgh, and it's a part of this tapestry, intellectual tapestry, that is so intrinsic to the city. So you feel the history of the city with its great thinkers over the centuries, and you feel this continuation, this lineage of academic discipline that is reaching, starting from, let's say, Scottish Enlightenment and coming to today. There is this continuity, and just being part of it, it gives you this feeling of being at an international place which is in Scotland, but at the same time, it has a true global reach. The university feels that it is timeless and somehow belongs to the world. In a way that is unique.